Hey, what's up, Street Talks? This is Eric Kim from the Eric Kim Street Photography Blog. So I just came back from a lovely road trip up to Portland and Seattle with the woman of my life, Cindy, and her younger sister. And I'd have to say it was one of the most incredible journeys I've had in my life in terms of the ride. So beautiful. If you've ever driven from LA to the Bay Area on the 5, worst drive ever, take the 1 up north. It will absolutely blow your mind. So I just had a wonderful time up there. Lots of great coffee, lots of great donuts, and lots of flannel. And yeah, super cool places to check out if you've never been there. Also, it was nice on the way back, we were able to check out some redwoods. And every time I travel, it's always really hard to kind of get back in the flow of things. But one of my resolutions for this year was I want to create 10 times the value for photographers, you know, whether street photographers or any other photographers, and really dedicate my life to helping as many people as I can. Some of my biggest inspirations include James Altucher, who runs a podcast and a blog. You know, James Altucher, just Google him. Tim Ferriss, and you know, some other guys like Elon Musk, Steve Jobs. And I think all these guys were really focused on delivering more value than they take. And so one of the things I want to start doing is doing more of these YouTube video lectures in which all these materials are what I show my workshops, and essentially try to make myself redundant, because I know not everyone out there is able to attend my workshops either because of cost or location. And in the spirit of my open source ethos, I want to make this all open and available to anyone, any of you guys who are interested in learning about it. So in the last lecture I recorded, it was on overcoming your fear of shooting street photography. This week's lecture is going to be on how to be invisible when shooting on the streets. So I remember a few years back when I was on Facebook or Twitter, I asked people, if you had one power, superpower in street photography, what would it be and why? And 99.9% of people said, I wish I was invisible when I'm out shooting on the streets, because I don't want people to notice me. I want to make candid photos. And essentially, I want to be like this guy, you know, the guy with the floating glasses. So when people say that they want to be invisible when they shoot street photography, I think of several solutions. So, you know, I'm going to give you guys practical tips on how to be invisible when you're shooting street photography. But honestly, I would say, based on my experiences shooting street photography, being invisible is highly overrated. What do I mean by that? First of all, I think when people often look at cameras, they see a camera as a problem rather than a solution. What I mean by that is that sometimes you become super self-conscious by having a camera, like, oh, I don't want people to know I'm a photographer, blah, blah, blah. But having the camera is actually an amazing thing, because the camera is almost your, you know, golden ticket to the life of somebody else. What I mean by that is, if you were a photographer without a camera, you would never really have the opportunity or the reason to enter into somebody else's life. So for example, let's say I'm at a cafe and I'm enjoying my espresso and I see, you know, an older gentleman with great wrinkles in his face, and is also enjoying his cappuccino or whatever, and the light is hitting him in such a way that's so beautiful that I just want to capture that spirit and that soul and that amazing light. If I wasn't a photographer or a street photographer, I might just stare at him. That is really awkward. But if I start taking photos of it, and let's say the guy came up to me and is like, oh, you know, what are you doing? I would say, you know, I'm a photographer, and the reason I'm making this photo is because you have a great face. I love the mood, the emotion, and the light that is hitting you right now. It's just amazing. And if you're shooting digital, you could show them the back of your camera and be like, this is why I made the photograph. I'm trying to make beautiful images. I'm trying to create art. And you're adding value to that guy's life too. So if you weren't a street photographer or a photographer with a camera, it would just look really weird just staring at the guy. I have another story. I'm not sure if I shared this before, but I remember this one time I was just walking around. There's like this abandoned construction site, and there are some sort of guards in the way. I had my camera around my neck, and I'm just like, you know, do-do-do-do-do, you know, like touristy Asian guy with a camera on his neck. And I'm, you know, I'm just kind of peeking over into the construction site, and the guy looks at me and says, what do you want? What are you looking at? You know, scram kind of thing. And I explained to him, I'm a photographer, and you know, there looks like lots of really cool, interesting things to shoot there. I've never seen the place. And I started chatting with the guy, and he told me, oh, because you're a photographer, you know, there's some really cool places I want to show you. Come on in. Let me in. Ended up making some cool photos. Imagine that I didn't have a camera with me around my neck. The guy would probably just stare at me and be like, what are you looking at? And I would say, oh, I'm just curious what's in there, or looks interesting. And then the guy would look at me as like, dude, what the hell are you doing? Like, get the hell out of here. But because I had a camera on my neck, it signaled to him that I probably wasn't a threat. Rather that I was just a photographer, just a curious, tourist, or I made photos for the love of it. Rather than if I didn't have a camera with me, they might be suspicious, like, oh, this guy's a hoodlum. Maybe he has some like spray cans. He just wants to tag up the place. Obviously, you might make the argument that, oh, people are more suspicious of you because you have a camera. There's a caveat with that. There's a saying, creepiness is proportional to focal length. Let that sink in for a moment. Once again, creepiness is proportional to focal length. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is this. Generally, the longer your lens is, the creepier you're going to look. And so when it comes to shooting street photography, you don't want to look creepy. And the way you do that is try to have as small as the camera as possible. So generally, I'm not a real huge fan on huge, big, bulky DSLRs with 70 to 200s because if you have a big camera, it screams, I'm a professional, I'm doing something sneaky. But if you're shooting with a smaller camera, the camera I recommend most people, if you're just starting off, just shoot with your smartphone, whether it's an iPhone or a Galaxy or whatever it may be, or just compact cameras. My biggest recommendation is the Ricoh GR. APS-C sensor, 28mm/35, there's a crop sensor. So it's 28mm full frame equivalent, but you could crop in camera to a 35, which I personally do. Stick in your front pocket, make photos, great. Or Micro Four Thirds cameras, Olympus OMD is great. The Fuji X100T, probably the best bang for the buck street photography digital camera out there in the market. Or, personally, I like to shoot with a film like an MP, the 35. I've had this about last maybe like 3 years. It's just, small and compact enough I always carry with me. And having a smaller camera will signal to your subjects that, this guy's more of a hobbyist, is not there to just like be creepy. Having said that, I know some street photographers who use really big cameras, but because they have such a warm and non-creepy demeanor, most people don't really mind them. So the first thing I want to mention to you guys is, even though this is a lecture on how to be invisible when shooting as a street photographer on the streets, you just ask yourself, why do I want to be invisible when I'm shooting street photography? Another reason people tell me I want to be invisible when I shoot street photography is because I want to make candid images. So when people say this, I respond by saying several different things. First of all, what do you mean by quote, quote, candid? Which means that you've taken the photo without them noticing you take the photo, or you've taken the photo and you don't want them to notice that you've taken the photo after you've taken the photo, or are you just kind of afraid that the person's going to get angry? So first of all, I'm not a big fan of hiding the camera. I think it tends to be a little bit more on the sneaky side. So don't hide your camera like behind your back when you're about to take a shot. Bring it on, take a shot. It's almost like you're pulling a gun out of your pocket, and then people are going to freak out. If you have a camera around your neck, honestly, you're going to look more like a tourist. You're probably going to blend in more, and more people are going to be comfortable with you because you're being open, transparent, and you have nothing to hide. And so the biggest secret to being candid and taking photos without people noticing is honestly just being really quick. So for example, when I shoot with my Leica, I just have it around my neck, right? And I'm just walking around. And I always have my camera set to f8 so I could have maximum depth of field. I already have my shutter speed, whatever it is. I have ISO 400 film in here, Kodak Portra 400. I know my settings, I know my distances. So bright sunny day, thousandth of a second, shutter speed. That's why I always have it set. And I'm really good at zone focusing or pre-focusing based on how far somebody is. So if someone's walking towards me and I want to take a photo of them, that's about two arm lengths away. I already know that's 1.2 meters, AKA around 4 feet. And my finger is going to be pre-focused to the little tab at the bottom. So I just have the camera on my neck and they're walking towards me and I'm just walking normally. And then when they're about shooting distance, I just bring it up and quickly snap. And because I'm so quick, people don't have the chance to react. So, you know, that's how you get the candid shots. Generally, whenever you take photos, when people are staring at you or you break the candidness, it's either that you've taken the shot too slowly, like you bring it up, you try to focus, or your camera's autofocus is slow, whatever, or you're taking forever trying to get the composition perfect, then people notice you and you no longer have a candid moment. However, at the same time, I do believe you could get quote-unquote candid moments even when you're asking for permission. I like to call this the unguarded moment. I got it from Jeffrey Dyer, who's a great photography writer. And so the idea is, you know, you're talking to a stranger, you say, oh, you know, you're so cool, do you mind if I take your portrait? And if they say yes, you're like, all right, cool. And you start taking photos and, you know, obviously they're throwing up the peace sign, whatever. One tip I like to do is ask them just, you know, how's your day going or where you're from or tell me your life story. And while they start talking, suddenly they, you know, get into storytelling mode and totally forget about your camera. And in those moments, I start clicking. And even though it's not candid in the sense that they know you're there and you're taking photos, they're not aware of the camera. And I think that's the biggest thing, is that when you're shooting street photography, you don't want people to be aware of the camera. Several ways to do that. Once again, don't have a super big, you know, professional looking camera strapped around your neck or your hand. And if you're shooting on the streets, sometimes the best way to blend in and be invisible is just look like a total tourist. And I'll get back to that. So, you know, if you're shooting in, let's say, downtown Los Angeles, if you want to look like a tourist, maybe it's a good idea to wear that little bright red fanny pack. Or maybe on the other hand, you dress as a local and just get some like $300, you know, salvage raw denim and look like a hipster, grow a beard, whatever. There's many different ways to kind of blend it. So moving on, let me just talk a little bit about some specific tips on how to be more quote-unquote invisible when shooting on the streets. The first strategy I have is pretend like you're shooting a photo of something behind somebody. So this is a tip that I got from Bruce Gilden, and he has a famous photo in which there's a guy, he's pushing like a Coca-Cola cart, and behind him, there's a photo of a dog. One second. Let me see if I can pull it up. Bruce Gilden dog. Yeah, here it is. So it's a photo by Bruce Gilden, and very conveniently on streetphotographyworkshops.info. So he's here taking a photo, and he's so close. Bruce Gilden shooting with a flash and 28mm lens. Gilden's taking a photo of this guy juxtaposed against his dog, but this guy's turning around because he thinks he's taking a photo of his dog. Similarly, whoops, that's not it. Where am I? There you go, keynote. Okay. So in this shot, essentially, I was in New York City. I see this this poster and this huge face and this woman in front. And without thinking too much, I had my Leica. I had my Leica MP 35mm with a flash on. Flash at 1/8 power, so that's about 1.7 meters. Camera at f8, 50th of a second, ISO 400 film. And I just took the photo real quick. And, you know, and I just kept walking. The lady kind of turns around and is wondering what I'm taking a photo of. And she just assumes that it was a photo of what I took behind her. Ironically enough, sometimes the best way to be invisible when you're shooting street photography and be less suspicious is just get really close to people. Because if you're really close to somebody taking a photo of them, they almost always assume that you must be taking a photo of something behind them. Because they're thinking, who is crazy enough to be taking a photo of me at that close of proximity? So, you know, once again, I think when you're shooting street photography, sometimes getting closer is a lot better in terms of just kind of blending in. The second technique is called the quote-unquote video camera technique. I got this from either my friend Charlie Kirk or Gary Tyson from Hong Kong. I'm not sure who exactly taught me this, but pretty much the concept is this. So have you ever been in, like, let's say Times Square, somewhere really busy downtown area, where you see a bunch of tourists, fanny packs, and the video recording cameras recording like everything, like a panoramic 360 view of the entire world? So if you've been in that instance where you've got caught in the line of fire, does that upset you? Probably not. Why does it not bother you? You might be thinking to yourself, oh, it's because they're just kind of recording everything. They're not like just recording just me, which might be a bit creepy. They're just kind of recording everything. So most people generally ignore people who make videos. And especially if done on iPads. So another technique that I recommend if you want to be invisible when you're shooting, it's called the video camera technique. So depending on whatever camera you have. So if you have a camera with an LCD in the back of the screen, like let's say a Ricoh GR, you could just literally walk around the streets pretending that you're just making a video. And the entire time, just hold the camera up to about waist level, like you're framing and shooting from the LCD screen. And when you're starting this assignment, don't even take any photos. Just hold it up, pretend like you're shooting a video. And some people might look at you weird, but they can't get angry at you because you're literally not taking any photos. And someone might be like, did you take a photo of me? He's like, no, I didn't, because, you know, I'm just holding my camera, walking around. Like, what's your deal? And he's like, oh, show me the photos. And show him the photos. You haven't taken any photos. You're not doing anything wrong. The second step is walking around and then pretending like you're videoing. And then while doing that, you start clicking. And the next step after that is, you know, take your camera, if assuming you have a viewfinder, hold it up to your eye, walk around, and just get really close to people, like within an arm or two arm lengths away, and just point it at them and don't take any photos. And just through the viewfinder, kind of see their reaction and how they're responding to your movements. After you're comfortable doing that, then actually, you know, pretend like you're making a video camera and start snapping away. So that's the video camera technique. Lost tourist technique. I don't know if this is really a technique or is it just looking like a lost tourist. So this could also be called Eric Kim technique, look like a stupid Asian tourist. I have a funny story. When I was in India, I did a workshop, really hot in India in the summers, as you can imagine. One of the students comes to the workshop, he's wearing like super short shorts, like a Nautica polo shirt, a big floppy old lady hat, fanny pack, whatever. So we're out shooting on the streets. I'm just wearing my shorts and t-shirt, whatever. And, you know, if you've ever been to India before taking photos, sooner or later, you're going to get a bunch of kids running up to you, either trying to sell you stuff or, you know, asking for money, or they're just kids who are, you know, just want their photos taken. So me and this other guy, and, you know, the guy who's dressed up as a tourist, he's actually an Indian. He's a local, like he lives in Mumbai. He lives there. And we're walking down the street. There's a bunch of kids trying to sell drums or something. And they look at me, look at the other guy, look at me, look at the other guy. Guess who they ran up to try to sell the drums? Nope, they did not run to me, the obviously touristy Asian guy. They ran to the Indian local who looked more like a tourist and tried to start selling him stuff. So pretty much the idea is you want to look like a stupid tourist when you're shooting street photography. I know some people when, let's say, shooting in their own city. So let's say you're in Las Vegas. Let's say you're shooting street photography in Las Vegas. Buy a I Love Las Vegas shirt. Or if you're in LA, I Love LA shirt. Or, you know, be Asian. That's probably the best one. It works in every single country. Like, I'm shooting in downtown LA. People are like, oh, you know, what country are you visiting from? I'm like, I live here. But, you know, that's when I was living in LA. But anyways, look like a tourist. So don't try to be so sneaky and try to be stealth, whatever. Make yourself stand out. And the reason this is a good technique is that most people don't really care if you're a tourist, and they just kind of tend to ignore you, and they don't take you seriously, even if you're taking photos. And if people do come up to you and say, what are you doing? What are you taking photos of? You're going to say, I'm a tourist. And especially if you are traveling and you say you are a tourist, you get away with it. That's why most people are generally comfortable taking photos of places outside their own cities than in their own backyards. Or, you know, if you want to lie, you know, I'm not a big fan of being a liar, but, you know, you could just joke around. Let's say you're shooting downtown in your own city. People look at you and say, what are you doing? You could just say, I'm a tourist in my own city. And then people will laugh it off or, you know, whatever. Or you could be like, oh, I'm a photographer pretending to be a tourist taking photos. And sometimes humor is one of the best ways to actually de-escalate confrontations. Another technique that I learned from my friend, I believe this is actually from my friend Gary Tyson in Hong Kong. It's rather than approaching someone and kind of pouncing on them and taking a photo of them, what you do is you see somebody interesting coming from, let's say, half a block away, and then you hold your camera up to your eye, pretend like you're going to take a photo of something. And once they walk into your line of vision, then take the photo. But after taking the photo, don't immediately drop your camera and keep walking. Click, take the photo, hold it up to your eye, wait, then drop the camera and then let them pass you on by. You could also do this while you're moving. So let's say you're walking down the streets of New York City. You see someone interesting. You bring the camera up and click, rather than going click and dropping the camera immediately. Bring up the camera, click, hold it for about 3 seconds, and through your viewfinder, gauge your reaction. So if they look at you weird and move on, just let them move on. If they look weird, look at you in a weird way. Do that. If you're looking through the viewfinder and they're smiling at you, then, you know, drop the camera, smile back, start chatting with them and ask them to pose for you or whatever. But the biggest takeaway is when you're taking a photo, don't just click and then move immediately. Click, hold your camera up for like 3 or 4 seconds, and then drop it and move it. Another technique you do, and this is a little more sneaky, is you could bring up your camera, click, and they look at you weird, and then you hold the camera up, left, right, down, and then walk away. And then they're just like, oh, I guess they're trying to make a panoramic or something. I mentioned this before, using a small camera. So yeah, generally the smaller your camera is for street photography, the more stealthy you're gonna be and the more likely you're gonna be in terms of carrying around with you everywhere you go. This is a photo I shot. I shot this with the Filmrico GR1S, 28 mil lens. Guy sitting right across me, doesn't even notice me taking his photo. So generally I recommend small cameras. But even if you have a big camera, if you have a DSLR, maybe you want to take off the battery grip, you want to take off the huge zoom lens, get a prime lens instead. You know, using a small camera obviously helps. Another tip I have, and this is just more about kind of being fast, the importance of zone focusing. So if you guys have never heard of zone focusing, the concept is back in the days of film, before autofocusing cameras, you wanted to use, you know, a pretty small aperture, let's say f8, there's a saying f8 and be there, which gives you a pretty deep depth of field. And if you're shooting at f8, pretty much everything's in focus, and then you want to pre-focus it to a certain distance so you know what's, so you can just take a photo quickly. So for example, on the Leica, I don't know if you can see this in the webcam, but I'm shooting at f8, and if I'm pre-focused to about 1.2 meters and I'm shooting at f8, that means everything from about 1 meter to 1.5 meters is gonna be in focus. If I'm pre-focused to about 2 meters, everything from about 1.5 to 3 meters is gonna be in focus. And the importance of zone focusing is, if you're shooting street photography and if you ever missed a shot because your autofocus is too slow, use zone focusing. Now, if you miss a shot, it's pretty much only your fault. And there's many different ways to zone focus, and these are just some example settings. So if you shoot with like a DSLR or any other, you know, standard digital camera, I recommend just putting your camera into aperture priority mode. If you shoot with a film camera, obviously you have no other choice but shooting manual. Generally keep your aperture around f8 to f16. The deeper the depth of field, the better. I'd recommend f8 for most of the people out there, because, you know, that's also most cameras' lenses' sharpest point. So, you know, I just recommend f8. In terms of your ISO, generally the higher the ISO, the better. When in doubt, if you're shooting with a digital camera, I would recommend actually just ISO 1600. If you're shooting with a film camera, then you're only limited to like ISO 400, 800 film, then that's a different matter. The reason you want a high ISO is because it'll allow you to have a fast shutter speed. Rule of thumb is you want your photos to be at least 1/250th of a second to not be blurry of somebody walking. Obviously, if someone's running, you need at least, let's say, 1/1000th of a second. So generally, the higher your ISO, the better. Like even Gary Winogrand, Joel Meyerowitz, when they're shooting the streets in New York City with their Leicas, they're shooting Tri-X film, ISO 400 film, and they'd push their films to 1,000 ASA or 1,000 ISO or like 1,600 ISO, so they could always max out their shutter speeds at 1/1000th of a second, because I think in street photography, for me, I prefer shots with deep depth of field and sharp. And generally I'll keep my camera pre-focused at about 1.2 meters, which is about 3.5-4 feet. And that's about 2 arm lengths away. And what this will allow you to do is whenever you see someone walking towards you, you can just take the photo really quickly without, you know, having to bring up the camera and then, you know, fit around with the focus. So if you shoot with a rangefinder or you're new to Leica, whatever, do not, this is what not to do when you're shooting street photography with the Leica. Bring up to your face and trying to play with the focusing and getting the shot. No, you should treat the Leica like an expensive point-and-shoot camera. you pre-focus to like 1.2 meters, bring it up and click. If you shoot with, let's say, a Fuji camera, like an X100 series camera, if you have anything older than an X100T, like an X100 or even the X100S, autofocus isn't the fastest, so I'd recommend putting it to manual mode and pre-focus until like 1.2 meters or so. New X100T, autofocus is super fast. You could just mostly use autofocus. Also, the cool thing on the Ricoh GR camera, there's something called snap focus, where you could actually pre-focus your camera to a certain distance, like say 1.2 meters and so on. And so if you want to learn more about zone focusing, I think I have another video on YouTube. Just search zone focusing, or I think I have a, just Google zone focus Eric Kim, and I have an article on that which shows you diagrams and stuff like that. And I don't know if this is the last, nope, not the last tip. So tip number 7, use a wide angle prime lens. So I generally don't recommend using zoom lenses, because if you're shooting street photography, you want to eliminate variables, especially with your camera and your equipment. If you have a zoom camera, a zoom lens, it gives you more options to waste time zooming in and out. If you have a prime lens, aka a lens that doesn't zoom in and out, it allows you to just always know what your frame is and just shoot. I also recommend using wide angle prime lenses in street photography. Generally, I recommend 99.9% of street photographers to use a 35mm lens. I think it's wide enough for most cases, but also not too wide. A 28, a lot of street photographers shoot with a 28, but you have to be pretty damn close if you want to make a good street photograph with a 28mm lens. There are very few street photographers I know who do it well. 50mm, yeah, you could be kind of like a Cartier-Bresson and shoot 50mm, but I think in most cities nowadays, 50mm is a little bit too long. It tends to be a little bit cramped, but essentially you want to use what you're most comfortable with. The reason I recommend a 35mm lens or wider is because, you know, if you're taking a photo of somebody with, let's say, a 200mm lens, you need to point the camera and lens directly into their face, which is obviously going to make it obvious that you're taking a photo of them. And, you know, if you have a huge zoom lens pointing straight at you, obviously that's going to set up some alarms. However, if you're shooting with, let's say, a 35 or 28mm lens, you don't actually have to point the camera directly at somebody to take a photo of them. You could just be taking a photo with your camera a little bit more to the right or a little bit more to the left, where your subject is on, let's say, your left or the right side of the frame, and you could be pretty close. And because your camera is wide enough, they'll get in the shot and you'll take an image of them. Personally, I've been shooting with a 35mm lens the last like 7 years, and it's the only lens I own. And the benefit of always just sticking with one lens is that you get to know the lens really well, and you don't have to fumble around with learning a bunch of different focal lengths and stuff like that. So going wide angle, often better. I've made videos in the past about shooting from the hip. If you guys don't know what shooting from the hip is, it's pretty much the concept that, you know, you have a camera strapped around your neck or in your hand, and you're holding your camera at waist level, and without looking through the viewfinder, you take photos, and it's kind of like shooting from the hip because your camera is by your hip, and you're shooting without putting your camera, holding your camera to your eye. You're shooting essentially blind. And when I started street photography, I did this a lot because I wanted to be more stealth and sneaky, and I just didn't want people to notice I was taking their photo. But I mean, I've recommended it in the past, and you know, I do have my video. And if you are, let's say, shooting in North Korea or like a war zone, you really, really don't want to get caught, yeah, maybe you want to shoot from the hip. Or if there's a situation where, let's say, you're on the subway and your camera's around your neck and something happens so quickly that you just want to, there's not even time to bring it up to your face, then maybe, yeah, shoot from the hip, whatever. But I would say for 99% of the times, shooting from the hip I found to be one of the biggest barriers to overcoming your fear of shooting street photography and building your confidence. The reason being is that if you're shooting from the hip, you're probably going to shoot from the hip a lot, and you're never going to develop a sense of composition, framing, because no matter how good you are at shooting from the hip, I know some people who are pretty good at it, your hands are never going to be as accurate as bringing the camera up to your eye and using the viewfinder. And not only that, but you always kind of get this weird, super low angle that, you know, it's kind of edgy in some shots, but if you do it over and over and over again, it's pretty obvious that you shot from the hip. And intrinsically, there's nothing wrong shooting from the hip, but most street photographers I know who are pretty well established kind of look down on shooting from the hip. Part of it is because, you know, a courage issue, and part of it is that the compositions and framing just generally tend not to be as good when you're shooting from the hip. Furthermore, if you get caught shooting from the hip, you're going to be in big trouble. So imagine you're shooting in the streets, you want to take a photo of a kid, right? And if you shoot a kid from the hip and you get caught shooting from the hip, taking a photo of a kid, you're going to look like a pedophile, and someone might call the police on you, seriously. But, if you have your camera on your arm or your neck or whatever, and you see a kid, and you're kind of waving at the kid and taking photos, and you're being transparent and open about it, and let's say someone gets pissed off at you, they're probably not going to get as angry as you as if you're going to shoot from the hip and be sneaky. So, generally shooting from the hip, if you're a super, super, super beginner, I don't want to discourage it because, I myself have done it in the past, and I think it was an important part of my learning process. But if I could go back and tell my 18-year-old self how to shoot street photography differently, I would tell myself, don't shoot from the hip, Eric. It's gonna take you another extra 1 or 2 years to build enough confidence to actually bring up your camera to the eye. So don't be sneaky in terms of that. So that's pretty much my presentation on how to be invisible when you're shooting street photography. I think this pairs well with my other previous lecture on how to, be more confident and courageous when you're shooting on the streets. But yeah, closing points. When it comes to being invisible, honestly, it's pretty overrated. It's pretty obvious that you're going to take photos, and regardless of how stealthy and sneaky or covert you think you are, people are going to notice you're taking photos. And sometimes getting caught making photos is the best thing because I've taken photos where people have noticed that I was taking their photos, and I go up to them, I start chatting with them, and say, "Oh, you look so beautiful. How's your day?" And this led to some really amazing encounters. So yeah, some food for thought. And if you have any questions about being invisible, getting caught, being sneaky, whatever, building your confidence, you can just always go to my blog. It's ericinphotography.com/blog. Ooh, I could pimp out my blog. All right, so ericinphotography.com/blog, and you could always learn more about street photography. We'll have another article, How to Overcome Your Fear in Street Photography with a quote-unquote rejection exposure therapy. You could check that out, or you guys know my YouTube's channels. So yeah, check out my YouTube channel. And yeah, if you have any other suggestions for videos or stuff that you would like to watch, other lectures, stuff like that, you could always just tweet at me at ericinphoto. So that is, let's see, Twitter. Yep, so just tweet at me at ericinphoto, and I'll try my best to respond back to you, answer your questions, or if you have ideas for videos, questions, whatever, just let me know. And yeah, thanks for watching, guys. And yeah, if you want to subscribe to my channel, watch more of these videos, do so. If you also want to build more confidence in shooting street photography, shameless plug, just Google Eric Kim Workshops or here on my workshops page, see some of my upcoming workshops if you want to build your confidence more in person. All right, guys, thanks for watching. Love you guys. Until next time, see you on the streets. Peace out.